It's a great pleasure to be here in Heidelberg. Thank you so many for coming this afternoon. I thought I'd talk about the tyranny of health, which is, as Helder says, the title of my book, written quite a few years ago, 5 or 6 years ago now, and try and bring it up to date by kicking off with a statement made last week by the president of the British Faculty of Public Health, which is the major medical public health institution in the United Kingdom. Alan Marion Davis made a statement, can be found on the BBC website last week. And the headline of Alan Marion Davis' statement was we want more nannying, not less, in relation to public health. Nannying being the traditional theme of that's used critically about what are regarded as paternalistic public health interventions and have generally been used by critics of them to deter government and official medical interventions of that nature. These are depicted as nannying. What Alan Marion Davis is doing and very much articulates the prevailing view of the public health establishment is that we've got to make no more concessions to that outdated notion. What we need is not less nannying, but even more of it. And the great example that Alan Marion Davis puts before the nation of this that really has given great confidence to this whole world of public health is the effect of the success of the bans on smoking in public places, which have taken place in the various parts of the United Kingdom, and I know have also been some controversy in Germany about them, indeed throughout the Western world. All sorts of bans of one sort or another have taken place restricting the activities of smoking. This has been regarded as a fantastic success. And the point that Alan Marion Davis is saying now, and he puts this in very rather populist terms, getting the idea of that the medical establishment now feeling the wind in their sails now, where he puts it, we've got to stop pussyfooting and get tough around these sort of hard cop routine, you know. You can sense that feeling of getting with the people on this issue and feeling that they've got the people behind them. And so the themes he starts off with is where is this getting tough going to be done? It's got to be done first of all with the food and drink industries, and we've got the now familiar list of demands in that area related to health. There's got to be more mandatory labelling of food products so people can see what's in them in the supermarket. There's got to be bans on advertising of so-called junk food at times when children might see them, around children's programmes on television. Increased taxes on alcohol, restrictions on various discounting of alcohol sales. You have an issue in the cheap sales of supermarket alcohol, offers of happy hours in pubs and clubs, which are an issue in many countries. More restrictions on all that sort of area. What next? And you sense this, we're on a roll now. Where are we going to go from there? A whole raft, he says, a whole raft of legislation for health is what he wants to see. In fact, he sort of runs out of steam at that point because we're looking for, well, where is it going to go? And the only thing he can come up with is a ban on smoking in cars. That's the... And you see already an interesting shift here, that the populist anti-corporate drift of the earlier things that's supposed to be restricting the big corporations and the drink industry has now shifted to restrictions that entirely focus on individual behaviour, which is, of course, an entirely familiar terrain of this sort of thing. So we've got a very striking shift of direction there. But you sense that's the whole direction of these sorts of policies that are pushing forward in this sort of area. And the point he ends up with, which is really what I'd like to really discuss in some detail in the course of this afternoon's discussion, is that what we need is more legislation to save us from ourselves. I think that's a very interesting concept, the idea that the role of legislation in society is to save us from ourselves, and articulated around issues of health. And I'd like to, as I say, to come to discuss that in a bit more detail. I want to look at this whole subject, three broad sort of areas to try and discuss the different aspects of it. One is to look first at the wider context, the kind of historical shift that's taking place here, just to draw attention to how dramatic this change is, that this signaled indeed by this confident, almost cocky dismissal of the nannying point, that what used to be in the old days regarded as a kind of top-down intervention of the state in relation to health is now being reversed, and that recent measures, he puts it, it was ordinary people who really tipped the balance to change the law on these matters. So this is the the wider historical context within which these measures are put forward. Looking at that, then want to move on to look at two particular illustrations of areas where these sorts of issues have come to the fore. That's the passive smoking issue, which I've already mentioned, the whole notion of environmental tobacco smoke, which is a familiar justification for restrictions in those areas, and the whole thing about obesity, the great threat to modern society, that is the issue of health, which is the issue that is, and indeed Alan and Davis emphasises, which requires drastic, get tough sort of action by the state and by health authorities. And then, having looked at those things, I want to then turn finally to look more widely at what the consequences for health are of this general shift of the whole understanding of health and the whole relationship of the state to and the medical world to health, both to the health of the individual and, in a sense, to the health of society. Looking first of all at the wider social context. You see, I think it's very important to try to grasp how radical the shift in the relationship between the state and the people has been around these sort of issues over a relatively short period of time. It really has been very dramatic. If you look back, just by contrast, this is an issue, an area that I discuss in my book. If you look back to the 70s, when these sorts of policies were first raised, the idea of public health initiatives by the government around changing behaviour in relation to what were increasingly recognised as the major threats to health. By the 70s, it was already clear that people were no longer dying of the old infectious diseases, people were dying of coronary heart disease and cancer, which preventive measures were put to the fore, and this required treatments weren't very effective. Prevention was the key to moving forward. The first sets of policies that were promoted in Britain, in North America, and in Europe, also all these things tended to come in around about the same time in throughout the Western world. Policies of a broadly similar character, with all broadly similar, interestingly, lack of major impact and lack of success. First of all, the government measure, and this was very clear in the British example, had a very rather crude, a very crude victim-blaming sort of character. It was very much pull your socks up, idle, self-indulgent, smoking and drinking too much people, pull your socks up, start living a healthy life, otherwise you're all going to die young. That was the kind of general drift of it. There was also a marked lack of professional medical profession involvement in all this. Doctors at that time weren't really involved in all. They were doctors were carrying on in the old doing the treating people in hospitals in GP surgeries like I was. They weren't really totally involved in this kind of project. That wasn't the sort of thing that they were doing at that time. And therefore there was no real mediation between government proclamations, everybody should change their lifestyle, and the person in the street. There was nobody taking that message to each person in a way which was going to have any real impact. Doctors were not really all that interested in it for all sorts of reasons and didn't feel it particularly necessary for them to get involved in it. I thought the wider context, they had a greater confidence at that time in the more traditional biomedical approach to the diagnosis and treatment of disease. The third significant feature of that thing was the marked lack of public response. The people just weren't interested in it. It was very striking in Britain at the time. The health minister was at that time in the Labour government of the 70s, was actually a doctor, David Owen, and was very unpopular with the trade union movement. The trade unions were very hostile to the trade unions at the time were a very powerful force. They were very hostile to all this sorts. They regarded the government with great suspicion because of its wider policies and had certainly no interest in endorsing these sorts of policies, which they regarded as having a rather anti-working class character, which was, you know, then when there was a labour movement, was you know, quite a significant force. So it really didn't have much of an impact. If you look at how things have changed, what you see now is that this dramatic reversal has taken place where you see what seems to have happened. This is very striking about the process through which the legislation was introduced in Britain, where it was actually not introduced. I mean, people may not be familiar with how it worked in Britain, but it actually wasn't introduced in England first. It was introduced in Scotland first, when Scotland developed a degree of devolved government autonomy. One of the first expressions of their autonomy was to introduce policies on smoking before they were introduced in England. And that created a sense of this was a radical initiative that was taken elsewhere, and the British government was rather conservative and rather lagging behind. And in Ireland, of course, it was the first place. Ireland, of course, separate polity, but very closely influenced by England. And the Irish people was regarded as very historically significant because they had traditionally much more hostile traditions towards state authority, but yet on this issue of health they were led the way in showing how the state could intervene in this area. So it was a whole dramatic change, and the most striking thing that you see, the government seems to be dragged kicking and struggling against the policies pushed into it, and on the other hand, as far as the popular responses to it are concerned, it seems there's far from people being hostile to it. Actually, what you see is that people, if opinion polls showed great support for it, and if anything, people were sympathetic to wanting more restrictive policies, they want more extensive bans, they want the bans introduced earlier. And that the campaigning against it was of a very feeble character. You sensed that the lack of popular resonance was so great that even the tobacco companies and the alcohol industry, which is affected by it because of the effect on pubs, could hardly get it together to protest about it, because they sensed that the tide was against them. And I remember that, noticing this shift in opinion at a quite early stage, because I remember when these first bans started being introduced in an informal way in workplaces, and this is more than 10 years ago now, let's say in the mid-90s, you'd start to see around London huddles of people outside offices, now become sort of familiar, the smokers' huddle. And I thought at first, that's an interesting to see the smokers' huddle as an interesting new area of kind of collective activity and organization. What is what's the vibe in the smoker's huddle, you know? And what was interesting about, you might think, looking back on the traditional thing, that the smoker's huddle would have been united in a spirit of defiance and collective hostility and solidarity against this intrusion. Far from it. The smoker's huddle was united only in a spirit of moroseness and guilt-ridden anxiety. You know, there's no spirit of defiance there at all. It was very much a sense of, we're so pathetic that we can't even smoke. And one of the most effective propaganda tools of the whole smoking ban thing was to show opinion polls which demonstrated not only that smoking bans were popular among non-smokers, but actually they were even more popular among smokers, or at least almost as popular. That smokers too were saying, yes, please stop me from doing this. You know, it's that notion of that we need laws to protect us from ourselves. That's what the smokers were saying, protect us. This was a major shift in the it's what I want to draw attention to, in the balance between the state and the individual around this sort of issue. That would not have happened 30, 20, even 10 years ago. A very significant change. And it's interesting how slow the state was to pick up on it. And it was only a sense when they this is actually popular. And, you know, hence they're moving forward with it, because, as we know, we live in times when politicians are not popular, and most of the things that they're engaged in do not attract a great deal of public approval. You know, especially in Britain recently, we had a highly unpopular war in Iraq, provoking a lot of animosity, lots of other unpopular policies. The health policies are really successful. And so the government's, you know, immediately, I mean, they're very astute to that, something that goes down well, you know, they're going to go with it. So what I want to flag up here is that underlying this is a transformation in the position of health in society that's illustrated by this whole thing. And what's happened here is that health has gone from being how it was regarded, if you look back, going back to the post-war period, sort of 40s, 50s, 60s sort of era. Health then was a sort of default state. Health was what you were if you weren't ill. You know, it was a normal state of affairs was to be healthy. Illness was a sort of deviation from that. That's completely different now. Health now has become a sort of goal in life, an aspiration, something which you have to struggle to achieve with great difficulty. Then, I mean, this is the old, people may be familiar with a sociologist, American sociologist, Talcott Parsons, and his designation of the sickness role, a great post-war codification of this whole set of outlooks. Health was normal, illness was deviant. The patient was not responsible for his predicament. It was something that happened to him by, as a consequence, or her as a consequence of an external disease force that afflicted them. The affliction of disease upon the individual justified their withdrawal to the patient role, where they would either take themselves to the hospital or to the doctor, subject themselves to medical intervention, and they would be allowed, you know, the indulgence of that role, allowed off work and things like that for a very circumscribed period of time, till they were restored to the normal working business and they got on with that. That was the whole relationship of the individual to health and the world of health maintenance. And of course the relationship between the patient and the doctor was very much tied up in that way. What has been called a Cartesian contract. The patient surrendered his or her body to the doctor. The doctor left the patient's mind to their own business or to their pastor or according to their inclination, but didn't go there in the general day-to-day interaction. The patient brought their body to it. The doctor had a duty to deal with them. The patient had a duty to follow doctor's orders. It was a fairly clear-cut arrangement and worked reasonably efficiently for a period of time. It worked actually very successfully, particularly because it happened, that whole emergence coincided with the emergence of, actually for the first time in history, of successful biomedical interventions, antibiotics, heart transplants, hospital treatments, artificial hips, the whole panoply of post-war medical advances. For the first time, actual biomedicine could treat these diseases. So not surprising, it all worked fairly successfully. Medicine had high prestige, doctors had high prestige, patients went along with it. The whole world of health was fairly straightforward. The boundaries were very clear between the state and the individual. The state ran the country and the economy and the military activities. The individuals got on with their lives. The personal and the private sphere were separate from the public sphere in very clearly defined ways. You only have to kind of sketch out, do a thumbnail sketch of that world to see how much things have changed. All that has gone. Every aspect almost of that whole world of health has changed. The boundaries have all become blurred and relaxed and almost faded away. Health, rather than being a sort of default status, has become, as I was saying, it's something that you've really got to struggle to achieve. You've got to struggle to achieve it through subordinating yourself and your lifestyle in all sorts of areas to a somewhat austere regime. You have got to, under the rules of this, now everybody knows them, what you've got to, how much exercise you need to take every day, the sorts of healthy foods and things you've got to eat, the foods you don't eat, health in relation to sexual behavior. Every sphere of life is now codified in relation to health, what you can drink, how many units of, you know, everything is specified in considerable detail. It's the Ten Commandments rewritten in relation to the sphere of health. Almost contrary, I mean, I've given some examples in my book of the new commandments of health, which are specified in exactly these terms. There's almost a conscious recognition that the traditional forms of social authority, which are mediated through religion, having gone, they're now reworked around issues of health. The seven deadly sins have become the targets for health promotion around all these familiar themes. But health now has become something very fragile that's easily damaged. It's not the underlying sense of something that's just there and you get on with your life. It's something that you've got to struggle for and protect carefully, and not only in the lifestyle issues, but then you've got to subject yourself, take yourself off at regular intervals to your doctor for the appropriate screening tests and all the rest of it to make sure that you're doing what needs to be done and detecting early what needs to be detected and treating vigorously what needs to be treated. It's not something that's just there, it's something that has to be worked on very assiduously and zealously. And so you see the underlying notion of this is the is the idea of a fragile subject is what emerges. In the past, we had a much more robust individual at the center of our conception of science. Now we have a fragile individual. And the whole role of medical practice has now changed from being the doctor engaged in the diagnosis and the treatment of clearly defined diseases, very clearly recognized, to exhorting the patient to live a healthy lifestyle. It's a very significant transformation, the whole nature of medical practice. And so we see here that the old-fashioned victim blaming doesn't really work in this whole kind of conception. That what you've got is that the more that it's not that the victim is blamed, but more anybody who hasn't got disease is judged according to the effort they're making to pursue a healthy lifestyle. That's the index of virtue in modern society is how much committed you are to health. People say this to me all the time in the surgery, say, but doc, why am I ill? I go to the gym every day, I don't drink, I don't do drugs, and why do I feel sick? Because the idea is if you pursue a healthy lifestyle, you that shouldn't happen to you. And the other side of this, of course, is that you not only know about what your own your own level of virtue is. The sinner, in conventional religious terms, the sin is private to himself. But you stand at the bus stop, anybody can tell you what your BMI is. They know if you've been overdoing it on the cream buns, it's immediately obvious. Your BMI is open to public inspection, to a fairly good approximation. People can tell you what it is. And so it's a matter of public scrutiny, and that's what people internalize for themselves, and people do not hesitate to inform people if they think their BMI is excessive and the measures they think that ought to be taken to get themselves back into the land of the virtuous. And so what we see is that rather than victim blaming in the relation to the people who are actually ill, we see this stigmatizing of behavior on a much wider scale, and we see that the smoker and the obese person are the pariahs of contemporary society. It's quite interesting, I was reading Irving Goffman's book Stigma. I don't know if people remember, a great sociology study of stigma published in 1961 or 62. The British Medical Association is just launching, they're always launching campaigns against stigma. And I would make the point that if the British Medical Association is campaigning against some stigma, that stigma couldn't possibly any longer exist, Because the British Medical Association is one of those very conservative, it only kicks at a door if it's open. So if the BMA is campaigning against stigma against homosexuality, there is no more stigma against homosexuality, We've got television programs called Queer Eye for the Straight Guy. I don't know if this is shown in Germany. I'm not saying there isn't prejudice against homosexual people in society, but there's a fundamental transformation. I cite this point because homosexuality is one of the main issues of stigma cited in Goffman's book. But there's a fundamental transformation taking place. You now have police campaigns against homophobia in Britain. So there's that gay has become a sort of lifestyle choice, and it's cool to be gay in terms of design, clothing, and matters of that nature, as manifest on British television at any rate. So you can't, to say this is the same thing as just then, but I just make this point in passing to draw attention to the fact that they reassert this issue of stigma at a time, they want to, be right on in campaigning against stigma. Entirely ignoring the fact the main stigmatized people in contemporary society are smokers and fat people that the British medical authorities are in the lead of stigmatizing. People who are subjected to the most virulent public and private assaults. And I see the consequences of this in my surgery all the time, that people are because they're overweight, they're almost bullied by their children or by their parents and brought into the surgery, and they're picked out at school and subjected to all sorts of exercise regimes and told what to eat. They're held up to ridicule on television programs, a whole genre of television programs that ridicules people, invariably of poorer social classes because of their smoking and obesity. So it's okay to stigmatize those categories because this is legitimized by the new discourse of health, whereas some other form of stigma that exists 40 years ago and no longer exists, the BMA is really against it. So that's by way of introduction to set the wider context, the sort of historical context for this. I just want to look briefly at two illustrations of this sort of new public health discourse on health, just to show a few illustrations of it, really, to show what, you know, the corruption of science that it involves, which I think is a very significant problem, the subordination of science to propaganda in these areas, and the way in which politics drives health interventions and scientific, the whole scientific discourse on it. If you look at the whole question of environmental tobacco smoke, passive smoking, it's quite interesting to note that the first proclamations of the need, the danger of environmental tobacco smoke and the need for restrictions on public smoking were in 1971, the Surgeon General's report in the United States, and in 1972, and there was a major report that they produced. The 1971 was just a statement, 1972 was a report on the dangers of smoking, when environmental tobacco smoke was pronounced as a health hazard and carcinogenic, and the demand was made for measures of restriction. 1971 and 1972. Now, when was the first study published on the health dangers of environmental tobacco smoke? Any takers? 1981. 10 years after the campaign to ban it had started. So I draw attention to that because what it illustrates is that the whole thing is not driven by science, it's driven by politics. That the issue has been identified at a very early stage, that if you can manifest smoking as not being a danger to oneself but as a danger to somebody else, then it's gives you a much greater moral authority to restrict it. And that's been that recognised at a very early stage by the anti-tobacco smokers, anti-tobacco campaigners, and so that's how it was done. The very first paper is a Hirayama paper published in Japan in 1981. It showed a marginal increased risk of spouses. You know how this is done. You compare spouses of people who smoke because they're held to be long-term exposed to tobacco smoking. I haven't got time to go into all the methodological problems that there are in that and the danger of error in classifying people who don't smoke and to what extent what the real significance of the excess smoking is, the impossibility of quantifying that exposure. 1981, the first report. The same year, there was a much bigger study published, interestingly enough, in the States by a man called Garfinkel and others, which actually, contrary to the Japanese study, showed no increased risk of environmental tobacco smoke. Very hostile response it received. And led to the commissioning of more and more reports. And what you see then is the commissioning of more studies of environment. And by the end of the 80s into the 90s, there were something like 20 major studies that had been published worldwide. And on the basis of that, the famous 1992 US report, and these reports have been done in different forms in other countries, that environmental tobacco smoke was pronounced to be a known human carcinogen, which is estimated to cause 3,000 deaths a year in the USA. This is from lung cancer, and between 35 and 40,000 deaths from coronary heart disease. There was a certain shift from lung cancer to coronary heart disease because, as people will know, coronary heart disease is much more common than lung cancer, and the number of deaths taking place from it is much higher. Therefore, if you estimate the risks and multiply by the population numbers, you can create a much greater, bigger number of fatalities. It's a better headline. The problems with the studies, and there's a very interesting new book, which I was just reading last night on this, by Jeffrey Kabat, if people are interested in it, who's one of the major American epidemiologists who studied this, which traces this whole controversy. And the basic point he makes is that if you look at all these studies, they show variations around an increased risk of a factor of two or three of people who don't smoke compared with smokers in relation to of people exposed to environmental tobacco smoke compared with people who aren't in risks of these conditions happening. Now, let's put this in a bit of a context. The risk of smoking compared with non-smoking in terms of these conditions, particularly carcinoma of the lung, is of the order of, if you smoke 20 a day, it's about a factor of 20 greater. If you smoke 50 a day, it's about a factor about, no, so if you smoke 10 a day, it's about 20 later. If you smoke 20 a day, it's a factor of 50 greater. So in other words, the excess risk that's caused by direct smoke is astronomical by compared with these marginal risks attributed to environmental tobacco smoke. And the basic problem with those is they're so tiny that in relation to any other risk factor, they would be regarded as not statistically significant. But because of the political temperature around the smoking issue, they are treated as being significant. And that tiny number, then, if you can claim that tiny excess, which all the critical epidemiologists say would be lost in the noise of and the confounding variables and the problems of estimating exposures and all the rest of it, if you insist on that thing and then multiply it by vast population numbers, then you can produce an estimation of possible fatalities. It's science subject is reduced to propaganda, and it's driven by the need to produce figures to justify a campaign that's already been launched. And it's the Cabot makes the point that as the more the political temperature goes up, the worse the science gets. You know, and he cites a brilliant example of that. New diseases then are linked to passive smoking. So there's a report in the States published that makes a link between passive smoking and premenopausal breast cancer, that women who are exposed to passive smoking, you know, are at greater risk. Well, the interesting thing about that is nobody has ever established a link between direct smoking and premenopausal breast cancer. So here's an interesting thing, is that passive smoking is actually more is a danger for something that active smoking isn't a danger for. It's ridiculous. But yet it's become a major issue. Cabot, I first came across in relation to a controversy in the British Medical Journal in 2003, where he and another American epidemiologist called Jim Enstrom collaborated. They'd been publishing epidemiological studies of this nature for 20 years, and they had a big study in California, and they published their results of the excess risk of smoking. And their calculation was that the excess risk of environmental tobacco smoke was of the order of a relative risk of 1.05. In other words, an increased risk of 5%. In other words, not statistically significant. By comparison with the other studies, and at this point that Cabot made, their results actually weren't that different from anybody else's, but they were just interpreted differently. The other risk was, they'd say, was about 1.25, or increased risk of about 25%, which, as I say, given the difficulties of quantification, given the errors of classification of people in different categories, would be regarded as not statistically significant in any other area. So they published this in the British Medical Journal, and all hell broke loose, because they simply, the headline was, no excess danger from tobacco smoke. Well, of course, nobody wanted to hear that. And they were subjected to, there were several hundred, there's a facility in the British Medical Journal for what they call rapid responses. Anybody concerned, send in a response. They had several hundred rapid responses. Somebody then wrote a sociological paper on the question and an analysis of their responses, which is very interesting, because what he draws out is the vituperative tone of this correspondence, that to point out science which doesn't accord with the consensus on this is to invite personal animosity on an extraordinary scale, and threats to your job, accusations of corruption. They were, of course, blamed as being financed by the tobacco industry, because at some stage they had accepted some tobacco funding because their other funding ran out. But this, you know, because their findings didn't fit with the prevailing prejudice, they were subjected to an extraordinary campaign of abuse. Even though it was quite an editorial in the BMJ by George Davy Smith, who's one of the most well-known British epidemiologists and a veteran left-winger and campaigner against the tobacco industry, where he said, look, you know, you can't see any excess risk in this. So George gets all the abuse then as well, you know, even though he's been campaigning against this thing for years, and he's just joined into it. So it's just an interesting that, you know, you find in here, and this is what so bemused Enstrom and Cabot, jobbing epidemiologists doing this work for years, suddenly finding themselves in this position of being abused because their work didn't fit the politics of the area. And that's very much characteristic of this whole thing. What we've now seen since the advent of the smoking ban, there's been some controversy in Britain because there's been claims have been made of dramatic reductions in coronary heart disease in Scotland in the first year of the ban, which people can look this up because, you know, a high school, you know, a statistics student can see the flaws in the claim. It just doesn't stand analysis. There's even some considerable controversy in Britain about whether there's been a significant, so there are claims that the passage has led to a reduction in smoking. This is highly doubtful, but especially among young people, where there seems to be a slight increase in smoking, especially among young women. So the claims that the bans are effective in reducing, whether or not they're scientifically justified, which I would strongly argue they aren't, whether you could say, well, even if the science is crap, do they work, you might say, You know, actually, the science is poor, but they don't work either. Is the seems to be that, and that also seems to be borne out in the studies that have been done in Ireland. The other issue, of course, is that if people are banned from smoking in public places, they smoke more in private places, which, of course, is where they do more damage to children's health, because that's where children tend to be, in the home, which, of course, only encourages all the zealots to go in the home and stop them smoking there, which is presumably the logic of the new, the man I started, Alan Marion Davis, wanting to get tough. Tough in the car, next thing will be tough in the home. The obvious impracticality of such policies is just another whole area. Moving rapidly onto the obesity thing, I think that there are very striking parallels in here. I'll just give you one little illustration of the obesity thing. Every shock horror, you know, we had this whole thing in it that people are going to be burying their own children. The life expectancy after years of increasing is going to decline. There's absolutely no evidence for this. Life expectancy is increasing at the most extraordinary rate, in fact in a rate unprecedented in human history in all Western societies, to the extent that there's actually, people will probably know about it, a substantial discussion of what a problem that's going to be, supporting all these elderly people. I've been to 300 birthday parties in the last year of my patients, you know. I looked it up, but one of them was born in 1908, because the party was 1908. In 1908 there were 1,000 people, there were 700 people over 100 in Britain. There's 12,000, I think, now. It's a most remarkable phenomenon. And this idea that this is going down is absolute nonsense. And in America, where there's been an obesity panic for more than 50 years, the same trend is also apparent. People may not like fat people, but they're not dying any earlier than anybody else. That's the simple truth of the matter. There's these shock horror things about there's a lot of discussion about the BM, the body mass index. People know this index of height and weight that's used. In 1998, the National Institutes of Health in the States arbitrarily had some big committee, and they reduced the threshold for obesity from BMI 27 to BMI 25. Well, at a stroke, 30 million people became obese in the United States. And that's more or less par for the course in this general discourse. In Britain, the ninth for childhood obesity, which is a big scare, there was there's quite a thing in these figures. There's quite a lot of variations, annual variations. Part of it is to do with the measurement. I take an interest in this because in my surgery, we measure people's height and weight regularly. And what really amuses me is that everybody knows people lie about their weight, you know, but people lie to within 6 inches about their height as well. Everybody thinks they're 6 foot tall, you know, and they quite confidently register that, you know, what's your height, and they fill it in. It's 10 centimeters less than that, and it's deeply offensive to them when you say, look, you know, there's this. But garbage in, garbage out, you know, all these statistics are collected from GP surgeries based on often subjectively reported weights and heights. Would you believe that? That's what the statistics are about. I mean, it's an edifice built on sand. And so there's a lot of, that's the first thing to be said about it. The second thing is that there are a lot of annual fluctuations if you measure children over the years. They seem to get up and down. So what they do is they take a takeoff point where it shows it to be getting worse to the maximum extent. 1990 was a very low year for BMI measurements among children. So then everything gets worse from there. But if you take another year, it looks quite good. And in fact, the last few years have been quite steady. But all these statistical scams are used in the service of public health. It's a shocking carry-on, really, because the whole point is the good lie. If it justifies a policy which is generally held to be good, stopping people smoking, making people have healthy lifestyle, then okay, you know, don't let's worry too much about the statistics. You know, it's a very dodgy area to get into. Underlying the whole obesity, there's quite a few interesting critiques of the obesity scare now, and especially in the States, because it's been going longer in the States. There's a sort of prejudice. It's a sort of old-fashioned golden age thing. Everybody always says, you know, there was a golden age when everything was great. Children roamed freely. They ate healthy foods. They were apple pie. They had beautiful, shining cheeks. They played football from dawn to dusk. And they were all happy, and everybody lived in happy families, and everybody lived long and happy lives in a wonderful, sunny. The summers were warmer, and the snow only lasted a little time in the winter. You know, that sort of notion. And the idea is that childhood obesity is the curse of modern society. Look at the children, you know. All they do is eat junk food and lie about with computer games all day, screen-based entertainment, and we're all going to hell in a cart as a consequence of it. They're all going to be dying of diabetes and having amputations and going blind by the time they're 40. But if you ask for what is the evidence that there's some significant effect, well, first of all, what is junk food? I mean, junk food is a snob category. Junk food is what common people eat, is what they call poor people in British society. You know, it's a sort of snob thing. The idea that you can define some particular food as having less nutritional quality than any other food. Food is a combination of carbohydrate, fat, and protein that you can get in all sorts of different ways. You need a mixture of those to develop normally. Junk food has got certain proportions of them. You couldn't live on a full diet of it, but as a great Satan, it's not. It's just another sort of food. But evidence that says that children's health has been adversely affected, even that children are eating that much more of it, or that their health is affected by it, you will look very hard to find it. All sorts of contradictory, a bit like the tobacco smoke, a very confused area. Screen-based entertainment, are children who watch too much, watching more television, taking less exercise? Well, big studies show actually a lot of the children who watch a lot of television also do more exercise. So go figure that, you know. Are children who are fatter taking less exercise and watching more television? No, actually they're not. Big studies in Australia suggest that it's not because they're doing those things. It's more complicated than that is the idea, the result of it. It seems obvious that's what it is, but that obviousness is created by a prejudice rather than by science. The other great prejudice, and this is also something that a moment's reflection would tell you, is that medical intervention in problems of obesity has some effect. Well, it's been one of the subjects most exhaustively tried, and you can say that doctors telling people that what you should do is eat less and exercise more, they've been doing it for 50 years, does it work? No, it does not work. It does not work at all. It is absolutely useless. So what's the point of pursuing a policy which has been shown through the years to be useless? And I'm afraid to say that all the further measures on that are more sophistication are no more effective. The only intervention in childhood obesity which is shown to have any significant effect is the sort of fat camp or steer regime that basically you send children off to a concentration camp for prolonged periods of time. That will get the weight off them. Short of that, the idea that measure their height and weight, which is what the government's done and is a systematic thing, all that does is stigmatize children who are a bit overweight and probably would lose the weight anyway in the way they always did. But the idea that it has a major effect on their health is just, I'm afraid, nonsense. But, what is very striking is the consequence of this raising the temperature around these sort of issues, which is a very intense in British society. The campaigns that it now justifies are quite remarkable. I mean, one of the big smoking campaigns is the campaign which is based on the theme of children losing their parents. And the idea of it is to guilt trip parents that their children are going to lose their children are going to die as a consequence of it. I've seen this on several occasions in the surgery. I had a 12-year-old girl brought in by a parent. She'd been causing endless trouble. There'd been family strife going on, rows and, the usual adolescent thing. And long discussion about it. What was the root of it all? This girl had found cigarettes in her mother's handbag, and she was terrified that her mother was going to die, as the television adverts had suggested that she would. And the whole point of this campaign is to exploit the moralistic fervour of the 12-year-old child, which I can tell you, they are as implacable as an Old Testament prophet, And they are being unleashed through these campaigns on their parents. That's the whole point of them. Is that you get the kids to police their parents, which is, people may recall, a feature of the most totalitarian regimes to use children this sort of way. This is considered legitimate because of the status that the evil of smoking has acquired in our society. As I've mentioned before, the national sport in Britain, this Jamie Oliver celebrity chef goes around schools, telling kids what they should eat at school. I mean, The absurdity of it, I mean, when I was at school, we had absolute garbage. When I was at school, we used to be this bread and dripping sandwiches. Dripping was the sort of fat left over from cooking meat, It was junk food to the nth degree, Fatty, you could see it clogging up your coronary arteries just looking at it. And, you know, did anybody think that was caused the decline of the nation, you know, in the 50s and the 60s? Didn't seem to do any harm. You know, the food was crap. The kids got on all right, you know. School meals always been rubbish. But now it's the nation's vitality depends upon changing the character of the food. And Jamie Oliver's then off preaching to poor people in the northern city of Rotherham, which I feel particularly strongly about because I come from very near there. But that's to give you, but what's so interesting about these campaigns is that they're driven by ideology, politics, prejudice, not by science. The science follows on behind them, providing a legitimation, and to the shame of some of the scientists who are involved in this. That, you know, I mean, we know, obviously, it's hard to get research funding for your studies and all that, but it seems going a long way to go along with this. Just turning finally to look at the wider consequences of this, because what we see through all these areas is that the dramatic expansion of health, that's the historic trend. Health now is something which affects everyone all the time in every sphere of their lives. That's the whole transformation of health. Health, you know, there used to be a thing saying, health is not just the absence of disease, you know. Well, how much more is it than the absence of disease, you have to ask? You know, because if health is everything in life, then it's taken over our whole lives. And what it expresses is, and this is the really important point about this, is the new sense of personhood that underlies this new conception of health. That based on the notion of heightened vulnerability of the individual, we've lost the sense of active agency of the individual in favour of the passive subject. The subject of the modern health scares is a very passive sort of, it's a person who is the dupe of the advertising, because people see junk food advert, eat junk food. People see cigarette adverts, must smoke cigarette, because people are so impressionable and basically implicitly stupid that they're incapable of making conscious decisions about their own lives without directive, not just government intervention, but mediated through professional and the appointment. Now there are all these advisors in schools and in the communities being set up to advise people about diet and exercise and health and all these areas, the evidence for which is entirely lacking. But the underlying concept is the notion of the enfeebled subject, whereas in the past we had a much more robust sense of the individual as somebody with an active role in their own lives and more important things on their mind than health, a concept which now seems to have gone by the by. The important point I want to emphasize here is that this preoccupation with health is actually making people ill. That's the real paradox of this. And there's two categories of illness. I drew attention to this in the thing I circulated about this talk. There's two categories. One is the worried well. That's the people who are constantly having checkups and tests and worried about some new scare that might be killing them. And, you know, they come in through my surgery door every day of the week to be reassured that some new flesh-eating bug, you know, the spot on their thing is not going to kill them, whatever the scare of du jour is. That's a kind of well-recognized sort of thing, health-related anxiety on a big scale. A more important category, I think, is what I call the worried sick. You know, the consequence of, if you create the idea that the whole goal of your life is health, that health is something that your whole being is aiming towards and your whole quest of your life is directed to achieve, then in a sense, to the extent that you experience setbacks and disappointments and losses in life, you experience them in physical terms. They tend to make you ill, that you experience distress in the sense of illness. And I don't think it's surprising to find that we have had over the last 20 years a remarkable increase in illnesses which can't be explained in conventional disease terms, but which have a largely subjective element to them. One of the ways that the medical world copes with us is by giving new labels to those conditions, you know, like chronic fatigue syndrome or fibromyalgia or myalgic encephalomyalgia, which is one of the most, you know, absurd kind of medical labels for something. It doesn't mean anything other than a, you know, polysyllabic Latinate expression seems to endow something with some meaning. But that's a way of coping with that kind of problem. But that's, the most striking development of the last 20 or 30 years. And it's led, in Britain, it's led to an increase in the people who define themselves as ill for the purpose of claiming long-term incapacity benefits from about 700,000 to more than 2.5 million. About 1 million of those are made up by people whose illness cannot be defined objectively. It's medically unexplained physical symptoms. It's physical symptoms which are subjectively defined. And it's an interesting problem for doctors, because doctors are expected to tell employers, this person has got this disease. Well, the person says to me, I don't feel well enough to work. Well, if you don't feel well enough to work, you are not well enough to work. And hence, you can be registered as being chronically disabled, as indeed hundreds of thousands of people are. It's quite interesting that, and this is what underlies this problem, which many people have drawn attention to, of doing better and feeling worse. By objective standards, people in Western society have never lived longer and healthier lives, to a most remarkable extent. I've talked about the life expectancy issue. Child mortality is unmeasurable in most Western countries now, in a way that it was even 30 years ago, quite significant. Doing better but feeling worse. Objective criteria, the health is much better. But do any survey, more people say, I feel ill all the time, I feel depressed, I feel anxious, I feel unwell, or I have chronic back pain, which cannot be validated by x-rays or any other investigation. That's the modern malaise that is so creates such difficulties. The interesting, this is increasingly recognized as a problem, because it's a problem for welfare systems throughout the Western world, because it's costing vast amounts of money sustaining benefits for this population. So you might think that there might be a recognition to say, okay, this is a real problem. What we ought to do is try to get back to reassert, in a sense, a sovereignty of a physical conception of health. But no, the response to it is to expand the sphere of psychotherapeutic intervention. It's in a way to medicalize that distress. One of the big initiatives in Britain in the last couple of years is this happiness initiative, the provision of cognitive behavioral therapy, precisely targeted at this population. The idea is that if this population can be subjected to this particular form of psychotherapy, promoted by an economics lecturer at the London School of Economics, then, who's been taken up by the government on this, then we'll get them all off the dole and get them all back to work. It's a fantasy, but it's an interesting fantasy because it expresses the prevailing conceptions around these whole issues of health and how to deal with them. So, in conclusion, the tyranny of health is the problem here. Tyranny, but not as we know it. You know, it's not tyranny in the old-fashioned coercive absolutist state, the Prussian government kind of medical police model. It's not directly coercive in that way. It's much more explicitly coercive. It's more intrusive. It's more a colonization of the life world, in Habermas's term, in all these areas of health. It's more moralistic, and it's more internalized by everybody in society. And that's the very significant trend. What's also interesting, compared with most forms of tyranny, you might consider confer some benefit on the agency enforcing the tyranny. This one doesn't. What it does is it creates a large amount of incapacity in society at enormous expense. So it's not really any great benefit to its promoters, and it's even less to the objects of it, who are the casualties of it. And there is this sense that this drive, you know, the point I started off with, Alan Marion Davis, that the new public health initiatives are driven by the people. I think that's a misconception. But there's a kernel of truth in it, and the kernel of truth in it is that it's not as though the initiative comes from the ordinary people for these sort of measures, but the success of them is dependent upon the sense of individuation and vulnerability and isolation of the individual citizen in modern society. It presupposes that atomization, the sense of the individual being on their own, which is the result of all sorts of contemporary social, political, economic trends, which I haven't got time to get into. But that's what it presupposes. It presupposes the atomized individual who is in that sense of vulnerability and is therefore responsive to these sorts of initiatives, indeed wants more of them. And hence the fateful dialectic is established between a government driven to intervene in these areas because of its loss of legitimacy in all sorts of other areas and the isolated, atomized subject. The consequence of this, save me from myself, is the person who says, save me from myself, has given up on themselves. It's a surrender of the agency of the individual, which is a very historically significant thing. That was the great achievement of the Enlightenment. You know, the Enlightenment created the concept of the self-determining individual, the individual who is responsible for his or her own behavior. The individual who was self-determining, autonomous, and didn't tolerate the intrusion of the state other than on very strictly determined limits, or indeed of professionals in their lives. That's the underlying problem of all this. That as Helmut Plessner put it, the individual is a sustaining concept, that of being human, that depends on, that it's a basis of self-determination and responsibility. And that's what we risk losing. Thank you.
Yes, I have actually two questions. First one is, what would be the motivator between these government-sponsored actions targeted against smoking and obesity? What would be the motivator for the government? You mentioned that they've kind of just by accident found out that the public opinion is favorable toward these kind of actions, so it gives him some positive points, but I have a feeling might be also something else behind the motivation there. I mean, what I heard is that, for example, the medical treatment of smokers towards the end of their life getting more expensive, which then provides some strain on the state-sponsored medical insurance, which then which they want to offset by enforcing these policies. I don't know what your comment is on that. Does this make any sense? Second thing is about this passive smoking that you mentioned. I didn't know that the science is so weak there. Thank you for raising that. I was thinking this is rock solid, that passive smoking is causing health problems. But question there is, surely what is not debatable is that the smoking for smokers themselves is causing health problems. And what I was wondering, what do you think if government, knowing this, does the government have the moral right to step in and say, look, this is going to give you a lung cancer in a few years, we ban it. We simply, you know, we charge you a fine of 30 euros if we catch you smoking because we want to reduce this. Similar like seatbelt in the car, you have to wear it because, yeah, if you get, in case of the accident, it might save your life. So these are two questions. Thanks.
Do you want me to come back? Yes. Well, on the first point now, you see, I'll give you an example of this to illustrate it. Tony Blair, when he completed his first 1,000 days, 3 years in office, you know, as Prime Minister, was asked, you know, that was a sort of journalistic thing, what did he consider the greatest achievement of his first 1,000 days in office, first 3 years in office? And there were lots of different policies. And the one he selected was NHS Direct. Now, NHS Direct, people who are not familiar, NHS Direct is a 24-hour telephone answering service which enables anybody to phone any time of the day or night to ask for medical advice, and it provides basic medical advice to people or directs them towards health services. And to me, it's a perfect metaphor of the relationship between the individual and the state mediated through the sphere of health in modern society. It's a sense of you've got a government which feels itself out of touch with the people, and in which the traditional kind of methods of the Labour government, you know, introduced the National Health Service, provided hospitals and all that, that no longer cuts the mustard. Now the idea is something which provides a means of directly relating to each individual in the country by means of a telephone system. And you sense that NHS Direct creates a link between Tony Blair, notionally, and the isolated, atomized individual feeling anxious about their health in the early hours of the morning, perhaps worrying about some health issue, that they can phone Tony Blair directly, you know, by proxy, to say, I'm worried, Tony, and Tony reassures them and puts them in touch with the right health aid, and so it goes on. That seems to me to be the metaphor of the new relationship between the state and the public in relation to health. And you see that for a politician who everything is, you know, distrusted in every other area, how valuable is that? You know, that seems to be something that is very precious to them, and it's not surprising that they've made these sorts of initiatives. They've gone further and further down that sort of road. The point about the rocks, it's very interesting. People take the science to be rock solid, but it is quite interesting. People may know Richard Doll as the great British epidemiologist who discovered the link between cigarette smoking and lung cancer, or first. Of course, it was discovered in Germany before that, but we'll leave that issue to one side. But Richard Dogg claimed the primacy of it in Britain. In 1954, with a famous study which was based on British doctors and showed that, because they could be relied upon at the time to fill in the questionnaires, and this relationship was shown at a very early age. In 2004, Richard Dogg published a 50-year follow-up of the same study, which is quite a remarkable achievement, because 50 years on the boat was 92 when it was presented. So there's a big hoo. I went to the launch of it at the Royal College of Physicians. Richard Dawes there, the great, he died a couple of years later, the grand old man of British epidemiology. This was the great achievement of epidemiology. Nothing else has come close to it. And that's one of the problems, is that the quest for something similar, that there's such a strong relationship, it's so clear, and it's so, you know, leads directly to effective measures of prevention. That's what they've tried to find anywhere, not found it anywhere else. All the other health advice is fine-tuning compared with smoking. The headline of that paper was that smoking takes 10 years off your life. Dahl himself was smoking at the time of the original study and gave it up, as he said, and got him to 92. What was also interesting about that thing, people asked him about passive smoking, and they had this endless problem with Richard Dahl, because he was always being asked about passive smoking. He thought he was rubbish, and they had to keep shutting him up. Because there's a famous British radio program called Desert Island Discs, where celebrities go on and they select their records. And at the end of that, he blurted out he thought passive smoking was rubbish. There was no problem with it. He didn't mind if people smoked around him. But he really objected to the passive smoking promotion, actually, because it disparaged the strength of the science of active smoking. You know, that was good science. This was crap science, and he disliked the two being put together, because it disparaged his great achievement. And all the rest of them are saying, you know, he's getting on a bit, you've got to shut him up, the old man, you know. It was quite amusing. The issue of, you might say, yes, look, there's a problem here. Smoking is bad for you. It takes a lot of time off. It causes a lot of ill health. It kills people. Unfortunately, there's a lot of things people do that are bad for them. And it's a very allure. If only they could be stopped doing it, yeah, it would save a lot of suffering, it would save a lot of money, and everybody would be better for it. But it's not that straightforward. The Lancet called for a ban on cigarette smoking. But, you know, to the extent that, and this is one of the things they want to, there's always a simple solution to these. Oh, put the price up. Make it so expensive it doesn't work. Well, I've got several of my patients. I practice in an area of London, Hackney, which is known for its crime activity. Several of my patients are actively engaged in the cigarette smuggling scams. About 20% of cigarettes currently on sale in London are smuggled. And, you know, it's as clear as the whole experience of prohibition on alcohol. All you do if you prohibit something like that is you create a black market and create a whole sphere of criminality, which is an even bigger problem than the problem you're trying to deal with. So it's a simple solution, but it won't work. So you've got to say, yeah, okay, we've got a problem. Is the problem that people who smoke don't know it's bad for them? I don't think so, you know. I don't think so. There's no good people come into my surgery coughing and sputtering and say, hey, did you know that cigarette smoking is bad for your health? I should stop it. Yeah, I don't want to. That's not what people come to the doctor for, you know. You know, what on earth? You know, they know that. It's not easy to give it up. You know, there are all sorts of complicated reasons why people do it, like a lot of other things they do that are bad for them. But you know, we've got to deal with that. There's no good, you know, kind of lashing out and, you know, implementing policies that are not justified and not practicable and are not soundly based on science. And that's the point I'm trying to draw attention to, is what we've got here is the corruption of science by the desire to do something that works, which actually doesn't work.
All right. Thank you for a very nice, stimulating talk. I wonder how many of your arguments are actually indicative of a more general kind of dependency and fear culture that seems to be so prevalent in the West. And, you know, one would imagine that the person that says, save me from myself when I drink or eat junk food or whatever, is also likely to say, save me from terrorists, anthrax attacks, yes, or save my daughter from choking on the Kinder Egg surprise or whatever it is. And I wonder if it's always the case that it's part and parcel of this general dependency on the state or the nanny state, or are there examples where there's an uncoupling where health has particularly shifted, or people, let's say, reject health advice, however, they're particularly keen on other aspects of society and behaviour being even more strictly controlled by the state?
I think it's the kind of thing that what you notice as a doctor is that everybody has their weak point. You know, some people are worried about some scares and not about other scares. And some people, you know, obviously people's worries are to some extent irrational. I remember there was a big scare about the pill a few years ago, the contraceptive pill. And women had come in, oh, God, this pill causes increased risk of thrombosis and all that. You had this 20-minute discussion about the risk of thrombosis. And the end of it, they say, well, I'm smoking 20 a day. And, this risk of smoking 20 days like this, the risk of coronary thrombosis is like this. The discussion is completely ridiculous.
For example, in Germany, 50% of the adult population smokes.
Yes.
These health, I don't think there's any bans on junk food advertising to children, so on. And yet people will stand and wait for the red man to appear at the traffic lights when there's no traffic. Every moving vehicle is triple checked by ear.
Yes.
So they seem to have, they want more intervention from the state.
Well, I think that's right. People are obviously totally inconsistent in how they deal with these things. But I think that the one point I would emphasize about this is that just because people, and this is the point about the smokers' huddle, really, just because people don't follow the instructions doesn't mean to say they haven't internalized the message. People just feel guilty about it and feel bad about it and, indeed feel really depressed about it. To often quite a demoralizing degree, and it's, to some extent it just makes people more demoralized, the intensity of this campaigning. So it's and people's response to it is not a sort of rejection of it, it's a fatalism. It's like whatever will be, which of course has always been a strong influence on the behavior of people who don't expect to live long.
So I have a question. So, well, basically, I think your point was that all this preoccupation with health does maybe more bad than good. But at the same point, you mentioned quite often that now the life expectancy is like super long. So, I mean, maybe that's a consequence of this, that people try to be healthy. So one could argue that it is maybe, I mean, if you say it's good to live longer, so maybe it's good to worry about your health all the time.
Well, I think that's a very interesting point. There's a very interesting study by a man called John Bunker, an American who was originally an aesthetist, of the relative contributions of various factors to the increased longevity in the 20th century. Because it is just an extraordinary phenomenon. And it won't be any surprise, in the first half, just I'm quoting the from memory, but the first half of the 20th century was when the biggest increase was a result of a decline in infant mortality. And that was largely to do with quality of living standard improvements, housing, hygiene, general relief of poverty. And infant immunization began to make a bit of an impact on that. Medical contribution negligible. In the second half of the 20th century, where the increase in life expectancy generally is slightly less, was not to do with the infant size, that was already very low, was to do with increasing life expectancy from the age of about 50. So it's people living longer. And the contributions to that are, from any health prevention thing, negligible, apart from cigarette smoking. That began to make a bit of an impression, because smoking declined from about the 60s very significantly. One of the interesting things about the decline in smoking, when the first studies showed the link between cigarette smoking and lung cancer, was it first didn't really get any significant publicity until the 60s. But smoking fell then quite steadily to quite a significant, in the sort of 50s, 40% of men in Britain smoked. I'm not sure what it was, but it was a bit less in Germany, but it was very high. And they didn't smoke just 10 a day, they smoked 20, 30, 40 a day. So smoking was an extraordinary phenomenon. I remember it in my childhood, that's what my father smoked. Our house, you could hardly see I can remember the heaps of ashtrays now, The culture was extraordinary. Just as an aside here, I read a fascinating book the other day, just to illustrate the cultural change, about psychotherapy conducted in America in the 50s. And there's just an aside in a discussion between an elite psychotherapist in Manhattan seeing a woman with her son who is difficult. And there's the woman is very tense, and the psychotherapist wants to put the woman at ease in this first consultation, difficult consultation in her consulting room. What does she do? She offers her a cigarette. Your jaw drops, doesn't it, And the amusing thing is, it sort of says it in parenthesis at the time, actually neither of them smoked. But the psychotherapist has a packet of fags in her desk to offer to the distressed psychotherapy claim, you know, you'd be in Manhattan. Could you imagine that now? You'd be locked up for that. That's probably a criminal offence. But that's, you know, how that whole thing's changed. I've forgotten the point I was going to make then. I'm telling that story. Oh, the life expectancy. Sorry. Yeah, so that's the smoking made a small contribution, but all these other things, you know, the diet heart disease thing is a complete load of nonsense in relation to its preventive value. You know, the coronary heart disease mortality is it's an interesting phenomenon in itself. It was hardly known before the First World War. The heart attack became a thing in the sort of 30s, 40s, 50s, peaked 60s, and then it started to decline again. The interesting thing is nobody really knows, A, why it increased, and B, why it declined. But it certainly declined long before any of these preventive things started to have any significant impact, either people jogging or eating margarine or low-fat foods or taking statins. So all those things have, but other medical interventions, surgery, better surgery, some of the treatment for high blood pressure in elderly people has made quite a significant thing to the prevention of stroke. So medical intervention has, you know, all the alternative health kind of people and the radical public health always disparage that medical intervention never done any good. It's all to do with improving lifestyle. That's largely true in the early years of the 20th century and up to then. But in the latter years of the 20th century, the relative contribution of medical intervention to increase life expectancy, about 40% was to do with that. But it's to do with actually the much disparaged biomedical high-tech intervention, not the preventive things, other than, as I say, the smoking thing.
So I'm just curious what your sort of vision is for how medicine actually needs to change in order to get rid of the tyranny of health and get rid of this sort of perspective. And the idea of sort of a personal genomics, personalized medicine, whereby science is going to eventually be able to predict what your individual risk factors are for developing certain diseases and what you need to do, what steps you can take to prevent them. And that the relationship with the doctor becomes more of a participatory sort of a thing. Do you think that fits in, or what do you think needs to change?
One of the whole things about the human genome project we were talking about this a bit earlier is that you know, this promise of the intervention that you've described has been much vaunted over the last 10 years, and it's nothing has happened yet. And whether it will, you know, you're telling me it will, but you know, it's not on the horizon, I don't think. And what I would like to see actually is the redefinition of health in narrower terms. And I would very much like, as a doctor, I would like to get back to doctoring medicine as the diagnosis and the treatment of disease. I think that in relation to all these lifestyle things which have now been brought into medical, and the whole idea is what medical practice should be doing, it seems to me it'd be much more useful if people did them at the gym. You know, people like going to the gym, it's a fashionable thing. They could go to the gym, get their cholesterol measured, get their blood pressure measured, to heighten with all that stuff. That's what they want to do. It's, to me, it's a hobby. It's a lifestyle thing. It's, people seem to enjoy it. It's got nothing to do with what I'm involved with, which is trying to diagnose and treat disease. And so the clearer that separation was effected, the better it would be for medicine, and the better it would be for the individual, and the better it would be for society. I can't say I see any immediate prospect of that happening, although I have argued for it in various places.
I have two questions. Do you smoke?
No.
Right.
I mean, do you want me to explain why?
Well, yes.
Well, it's a very simple thing. You know, when I was young, I used to play football, and I was not very good at football, and I was very slow, and I had this feeling that if I ever started smoking, I'd be so slow, I'd be absolutely incapable of playing. And so when I was a teenager, I, you know, felt like I just never could face starting it, so I never started it.
So the other question concerned the worrying ill. And it's actually those people who are not particularly ill, that they do not have a disease, but they still need attention.
Oh, yes.
And this to me seems like maybe a psychological disease, maybe a social disease, and maybe the efforts of the government and the money coming from the ministries of health should do something about these social habits and not so much about these individual habits. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, you put your finger on a very, very difficult problem. I entirely take your point that people are ill. It's not that they're imagining it. They are ill. They are incapacitated. They are more ill than people, than if they got an organic illness, which indeed could be, usually can be treated in a fairly straightforward way. This is one of the very big problems of contemporary medical practice. And what you can see all these problems that arise because somebody comes and says, "Doc, I feel, I mentioned it before, but I do all these things, but I'm ill. I'm feeling sick all the time. I feel tired all the time. I feel unwell in all this way. There must be something wrong with me." And it's interesting that patients in this sort of predicament, there's a sort of interaction. Doctors are desperate to give them a disease label, and they're desperate to have a disease label. And there's a sort of dialectic that then unfolds. I'll give you, if you insist, I'll give you a label. If you insist, I will. But the trouble with the label that's given to them is that it's rather than opening this, this is probably the traditional diagnosis, offers a way towards treatment. That's it's a counsel of despair, those labels. Chronic fatigue syndrome is a fibromyalgia. It's basically saying you've got that, there's no treatment for it, live with it. And people cleave very strongly to determinedly to the conviction that there's an organic and indeed vast area of internet activity is devoted to the quest for all sorts of explanations and diagnoses for this condition, which don't work either. And this is also a flourishing area where people, in frustration, the doctor's given them this label but can't give them any treatment. So they go and see an alternative healer who listens to them a bit longer and they find a more sympathetic, but also doesn't provide any treatment either. I don't know the answer to the problem. All I know is it's a very big problem.
Would it be possible to just regard it as an economic problem? I remember my father was a pharmacist, and I know he said about half of the prescriptions he sold every day was just to make people feel better, not to treat anything seriously. And if we just define all this, we say labels, that are still being paid for by the national health system or privately by people, if we took this out of the national health system, wouldn't that solve the problem? Because right now you get a free ride. You pay your fees or contributions to a national or whatever healthcare system you have. You're not feeling well, you go to the doctor, you spend a considerable amount of time there, you go to another doctor, another specialist, until you finally get a label, chronic fatigue syndrome or whatever it is. And by that point, you already wasted quite a considerable amount of money. And if we took this out of the healthcare system, wouldn't that solve the problem? Mm-hmm.
It's an alluring prospect. I think, there's a British physician and philosopher writer called Raymond Tallis, and he's makes the point that he puts what a definition of a human being is a pill-taking animal. And you can see what he means. People love taking pills. It's one of the, there's a discussion I read in the paper coming over on the plane this morning about the recommendation for people to take statins. Some British bodies recommended that not only people with, over 55 with very high levels of cholesterol, but basically anybody under the age of 30 with a high cholesterol over a certain level should take statins, the drugs that reduce your cholesterol level. And you sort of think, well, you go in people's bathrooms and, people's taking every morning the bathroom, as everybody knows, I'm sure some of you can testify to this, your bathroom cabinets are heaving with vitamins and minerals and additives and potions and all sorts of stuff. Well, you say, well, if you're taking all that stuff, you might as well take a statin, because that stuff's all basically rubbish. The statin, arguably does reduce your risk, long-term risk of coronary heart disease if you take it for the next 30 years, at a certain level every day. There's some evidence that that's true. Do you want to be doing that? I don't, actually. I have this discussion with patients. All people are coming into me all the time saying, "Doc, I'm 30. I had a bloke come in yesterday, said, "Doc, I'm 30 now. I've been told I need to have a complete checkup." It's the very, very common sort of consultation. And you sort of think to yourself, what on earth made you think you need a complete checkup because you're 30? But, That's, everybody knows, all these articles will tell people that. I say, oh, doc, I need to know what my cholesterol level is. Is that a particular issue, you know? No, no family history of heart disease or anything like that. No, but I thought I wanted to know, you know? And I said to him, well, look, you know, to be honest, I'm nearly twice your age. I wouldn't think of having my cholesterol tested, you know? And he said, oh, that's a bit weird, you know? And I said, well, look, there's two things, you see. If your cholesterol, this problem occurs all the time. Say somebody at 30 has their cholesterol measured, it comes in back at 5.8, upper limit of normal 5.2. Used to be 6.5. But another committee sat several years ago and had to stroke increase the number of people with high cholesterol by about 3 million in Britain. That was another. Anyway, it's 5.2. But my man of 30, his cholesterol is 5.8. Some of you have probably been in this position. So you say, well, what do we do now? Your cholesterol's, you know, well, man, I was feeling great when I came in here. Now I'm at risk of coronary heart disease. So he's off. We've already made a perfectly healthy, fit young man ill. And then, so what's to be done? Well, what's to be done? And I look, as a respectable British GP, my responsibility is to give him lifestyle advice, to advise him on a healthy diet. Did you know, young man, that if you ate fruit, 5 portions of fruit and vegetable every day and semi-skim, you know, and he's yawning already because he already knows all that stuff because that's what he's already eating. And anyway, he goes away for 6 months, follows that instructions to the letter, check his cholesterol again. What will it be? 5.6. Big studies have shown this. Big study in Oxford, whole of Oxfordshire. It will produce that kind of diet, which everybody's eating anyway, as it happens, as everybody knows. That will produce that kind of... So we have 30-year-old man, 5.8 cholesterol, 6 months of lifestyle, you know, healthy diet. What now? Are you going to take statins for the rest of your life? That's the question, you know. And not surprising, there's a vast industry promoting this, by which that committee, the people have made the point that the committee was entirely bereft of members of pharmaceutical companies that, you know, were marketing these products. So reducing the level, very good market, expanding strategy. So, and big money to be made in them. Now, you say, well, the statins do the trick, and they do. The statin is a very effective drug. The statin will, you take on a statin, diet for 6 months, 5.8 to 5.6, statins for 3 months, 2 weeks, 5.8 to 4.2. Fantastic. Brilliant. That's what it does. Does it cause serious side effects? Well, a lot of people say that, you know, small proportion of people, it does. 1% of people will get serious side effects, not very high proportion. But of course, by the time 3 million people are taking statins, 1% of 3 million is quite a lot of people. So, you know, that's the problem that then emerges. But, you know, that's why I wouldn't get my cholesterol tested. A, I've got no intention of changing my diet, and B, I've got no intention of taking statins. But if you know, that's why people need to know the consequences of taking these decisions. Because you can now get your cholesterol tested at just over the counter in a pharmacist, which people are also doing. Whether it's accurate or not, that's another question. What are the consequences of that? Are you going to live your life under the shadow of death, is what it means, taking statins every day? Not me.
Question on the role of science in all that business. So we had in our magazine Novo an article on passive smoking last autumn, actually showing how weak this, or there's no scientific basis on it. And it showed to me also that the kind of proponents of that idea are very nervous about being criticized. So we had 10-page long letters to the editor from state bodies and various people trying to convince her that we are on a wrong line, not with big arguments, but with coming up with moral arguments. So it showed to me that there's no big conviction or big strength behind it. So that leads me to the question, what is scientific communities? Why are they not, from your point of view, opposing that trend to a much stronger position? Yes. You once said there's a corruption of science by politicians, of course, but you also said that it's a shame that science is so much involved in that. And where just on the smoking business, I would see there is a big problem here also in the scientific community, that many, many of these institutions become really part and parcel of this project. Even here in Heidelberg, we've got the very respected Deutsche Krebsforschungszentrum, the German Cancer Research Center, which is one of the leading international scientific bodies, has become increasingly involved in a political campaign to ban smoking and passive smoking and all that. So could you comment on that, the role of science, how it should be?
Well, there's no doubt this is a big problem. I mean, I think it's a you know, the basic point is here is that scientists work in a, you know, and doctors work in this wider climate where there's a very strong sense that smoking is causing a lot of ill health and disease and premature death, and we've got to do everything we can to try and stop it. And the kind of, there's almost a sort of party line in the line is the cutting edge of the campaign is that we've got to, run by all the kind of medical bodies, we've got to kind of promote bans on smoking. That's justified by this scientific evidence. And so people think, all right, we know it's a bit dodgy, but because the greater good, it's the good lie, it's a lie, but the cause is good. So, you know, we won't look too closely. That's what it comes down to. And there's also, the two separate discourses then develop, because it is very striking. In the world of science, there's a sort of private world and there's a public world. There's a private world of epidemiology. If you say to anybody in the world of epidemiology, what do you think about the passive evidence for passive smoking? They say, it's bollocks, It's rubbish, That's not. But we can't say that in public because everybody knows, we've all got to pull the toe the line, which is to say passive smoking is bad for you, and we've got to get, do what we can about that. And so there's two separate sorts of discussion going on. And people then who breach that, and as you, you experienced a minor version of what Enstrom and Kabat got in the BMJ, and you pretty soon learn from that, if you want to, you're not having to kind of keep getting research grants for doing epidemiological studies. But there's people out of work that have, as a result of crossing over that line. If you say in public what should only be said in private, you're in trouble. That's what even Richard Doll got in trouble for doing that. So that's, I think, the overwhelming thing. There's a sort of corruption in a sense of that, people know that's, they are expected outcome of their studies, so they spin the figures in a certain way. That's not too difficult to do in a complex epidemiological study, and if all the there's a very powerful need to produce that sort of result, you can see the pressures towards that. And if there's a high price to be paid for not coming up with the best result, you can see the pressures for that too. So I think all those factors come into play there, the consequences are rather bad for science.
But I think we stop here for the day and thank Mike once again for a stimulating talk and a stimulating discussion.